Mentioned, my name is Saeed. I'm the co-founder of TranQool. You guys heard about us before. We are a digital health platform. I'm going to show you around like what we've done and why we are a social venture. Then I'll explain a little bit about social ventures as a whole. And we can have a little bit of Q&A in terms of if you have any specific questions on how to build one. And of course, it's a topic of your interest based on like what you guys have gathered here together. Mm-hmm. So, TranQool is an online platform with the mission to make mental health care, quality mental health care, accessible to every single Canadian. And the way it works, they're actually pretty simple. Our users sign up. This is not how it looks because it's like pretty like I don't know, it's zoomed in version, like it's not showing as it's supposed to be on my computer as I connected it to your device. But anyways, this is the idea. It's basically users sign up, give us some information, and based on the information that they provide to us, we have an algorithm that we match them up with a list of vetted and registered care providers. So these are clinical social workers or psychologists that they undergo through a four-step screening process. And they go through the schedules of these service providers, find the time that works the best for them, and book their sessions right on the platform. And when the time of session comes, both the therapist and the client sign back in and have their sessions through a secure video channel instead of going in person. So a little bit of more explanation. The pricing is actually key. So we got together as the co-founders of this business around a simple problem, which was the accessibility of mental health care. And we broke down access into different bullet points. So access is because of geographical locations. Access is because people have very busy schedule and they can't make time for therapy. Access is because of price. It's of course not everyone can afford the normal rates of therapy. Your students, luckily you have access to free therapy in your counseling center. Also you have access to TranQool because you have insurance, $1,000. But the private market of therapy out there is like the average rate for a psychologist is $185 to $250 per session. On our platform, it's $120. The average rate to see a clinical social worker is around $150 to $200. Our rate is $80. And also, like the people can't find time to go there to see a therapist because therapists have life as well. They want to go home, and people are working, and like there is only a limited number of sessions that they can provide after hours. We have sessions happening from 7 in the morning till 11 p.m., even on the weekends. And your access like is sometimes a challenge because people are living in a certain location. There's not much. Not too many therapists in that area. Like for example, rural areas, northern Ontario, we remove the geographical barriers altogether. Sessions can happen through secure video calls. So you can have your sessions as long as you have access to internet. So these were the issues that we got together and we wanted to solve. Actually, might be worth mentioning that like we come together in another session at OCADU. So I'm an engineer, and the other co-founders of this business are engineers as well. We are a team of 12 right now. But I'm not a social worker, a psychologist, a psychiatrist myself, neither are my co-founders. We are all engineers, and we're not even from OCADU. So what are we doing here? Actually, it's quite an interesting story. So we got to meet Catherine from Imagination Catalyst and like in an event, because we were out talking to people, trying to figure out if others have the same issue, or it's only us that basically facing this problem. And we figured, okay, to be very honest with you, I didn't even know about OCAD before Imagination Catalyst. And we understood that there is such program, and we figured, okay, as engineers, it's very good for us to be around artists, to have to bring another perspective, to live a different like approach. And because this, like what we are building, has a lot of design to it, and we started actually crafting a solution for this problem in a thinking session that we held in Greg's lab, in the Foresight Strategic Thinking Lab. So we invited a whole bunch of like psychiatrists, psychologists, some potential users, ourselves, people who have lived mental health experience, designers, everybody in the same room. And we discussed, okay, if we want to put together a solution, how would it look like? Actually, there is a presentation or a paper you'll find if you search, it's somewhere on your website as well. You can see we were much younger, it's like a year and a half ago that we got actually hold to building this business. But anyway, that's a little bit about what we do. Specifically, we are active in student markets. These are a list of the stuff that we handle. We work with OCADU, George Brown, Ryerson, Guelph. We are in talks with the University of Toronto right now. So we work with the Health and Wellness Center as a referral resource, but also we do a lot of advocacy work on campus through our ambassadors to increase health-seeking behavior. We are also active in the employee market. We have a lot of small, medium-sized corporations who are our clients. We do a lot of work in the primary care space. We get referrals from family physicians and hospitals. So that's an overall view of the of TranQool and what we have done so far. And with that, I'll jump into explaining a little bit of like building a social venture and what it takes to build. So first of all, what is a social venture? So I took this from Wikipedia. Of course, social venture is an organization that is around the purpose. Mm-hmm. So it's formed to achieve a systematic solution to a sustainable social objective. Okay, so that's the definition of a social venture. It can be in a form of non-for-profit, hybrid non-for-profit. It can be in terms of like community or school groups, or of course corporations. My most favorite is corporations, and I'll explain to you why. What is not a social venture? A charity. Charity is not a social venture. Because it doesn't, it might not have a solid, like, sustainable, basically, growth plan to make a social change. Charities, a lot of times, they basically like are as they go. Like they make plans as they go. They are like they have a social good, but a lot of times they don't have much commitments to make that good happen. And there's like there's not much accountability per se. So, what is the social business venture, which is what we are? And it's a corporation that is a social venture. It's driven by a social objective. It generates profits, and it wants to maximize profits, but also it reinvests it into the social cost and has investors looking for both financial and social returns. So why TranQool is a social business venture? And we are driven, of course, by a social objective. We want to make mental health care accessible. We generate profit. Of course, we have like the transactions happening on service on our platform. Accessions are not free. However, we reinvest it back into the cost. And by that I mean like no one on our platform is stuck because of financial barriers. So if anyone expresses that they can't afford our rates, our therapists are educated to give them like discount codes and sliding options, bring it down to where they can afford. So although we are for profit, but our profit, the first and foremost place that we invested is we invested back into the social cost. And also we have investors, both like venture capitals as well as individual angels that came on board. Of course, they want to make a return, but also they agree with us in terms of our strategy, and they agree with us in terms of our vision and mission. So, in other words, they want also mental quality mental health care more accessible. So, with that, I'll jump into like design thinking, like and how the process of building one. Of course, you guys all should be all familiar with this concept. So, it's a method of meeting people's needs and desires to figure out what is a viable way of going about an issue or a problem. So this is like we follow this fundamental basically both strategizing the business and also building our platform and the user experience and user interface. So of course, like you have to define the scope of your venture, what you want to achieve, And what's the big goal, big picture of your business or your non-for-profit? And then figure out who are the stakeholders. For example, in our case, we have mental health providers as stakeholders. We have basically the actual clients, the actual users as the stakeholders. Insurance companies are stakeholders because they reimburse from government as a stakeholder. They regulate the market. They also have, you have a single payer system, OHIP, that does not cover therapy unless you're referred to a primary care physician. But all of these that I mentioned are the stakeholders in this very specific issue and problem. And then also, you have to basically plan for growth, like have a vision of like where you want to be. Of course, at the beginning, you are super inflated in terms of your numbers because you're optimistic excessively. But, well, that's the nature of starting a business or a venture. But as you learn, as you get information from the market, you can fine-tune, learn, and move forward. And plan exit, which is very important. I'll get to it. And, of course, like brainstorm about unintended consequences. So, in terms of defining the scope, you have to define a minimum. Like, for example, in our case, how many people if we help, we were like minimum, like we are satisfied that we made a social change. The rules of engagement is very important. For example, our venture, we will not violate any jurisdictional rules. That's our rule of engagement. Or we will never ever put the interest of investors, like the financial interest of investors, in front of the social cost. So like there are some rules that you put together at the very beginning of these are, this is how we are going to do business. And also you define conditions that prevents the launch. Like for example, what if as a whole providing video therapy is something that is illegal? You couldn't launch TranQool, right? And then we have a lot of constraint ourselves. Like for example, you might it might be interesting for you to know that a therapist from Quebec cannot see Ontario residents by law. It's against the law because they are licensed for their own province, and that's a constraint on your business in terms of your growth, right? So if you want to go to another province, you must have go and recruit therapists in that very specific province. So any questions? No. You want to figure out the benefiting partners. Like there are definitely some people who need you and your service, but they're just indifferent. They don't care whether or not you exist or not. And there are some competitors, and there are some people who are your opposition. For example, you can understand if TranQool wants to make therapy more accessible and part of it is the price, there might be some resistance from people who are actually offering those regular rates, which we face it as well. But you have to figure out the strategies to show the situation, to define a situation that is win-win. Because if it's not a win-win situation, it's not going to be sustainable. If everybody in any type of dealing is one, if one side takes all, it's not going to sustain. It's going to break down like sooner or later. So we explained to service providers that you're not trying to compete. And right now, a third of people who need therapy actually make a visit to a therapist. So we are in the business of engaging that other two-thirds. And we are increasing the market size, and we are matching them with people who are outside of the region. For example, if a therapist has an office in downtown Toronto, they see someone in Windsor. That person ever could not make it to their office, right? So if they are seeing them, it's solely additional money that they are making, right? And it's not, like, they don't have to do it, right? There are a lot of therapists who are working in public system, like a hospital or a clinic. They have some free time after hours, they want to put it on our platform, and because there is no overhead cost, you don't pay for rent, you don't pay for like marketing, you don't pay for SEO, you don't pay for your website, you can bring your cost down. And at the end of the day, that therapist who has an office, they're not making $200 from session. They have to pay their rent, they have to pay their bills, and at the end, like the net would be like around $100, and we pay them the same. So like explaining to them that what you are trying to do is not basically conflicting, is not in conflict with their interest. So also in terms of like your growth, you have to specify a unit of business. Like on our platform, unit of business is session, right? One session is one unit of business. But also there is a unit of benefit, so or value. So the value though is not a session. The value is the person feeling better, right? Like if you take 20 sessions, but you're not feeling better, then you have like you make a lot of transactions, a lot of units of business, but no units of value. And also figure out the challenges of growth, like one of which I mentioned, like for example, that the regulations around providing therapy province by province. And also plan two scenarios. What if something doesn't go as planned? Like what are you going to do? Like there's three or four of you like building a team. You have to have a plan. Okay, when are we going to come to the conclusion that this is not going to work? Right? So you can't do like a failed plan. Like you can't continue like after 4 years, again, you don't have any customers, and you're still like a bootstrapping, there is no growth, like you have to have some sort of understanding. Okay, this is a success story, the minimum acceptable number of people that you're gonna get. If you don't, people don't need it. Or we're not the right people to make it happen. Or people are not trusting us. Or for whatever reason, this is not working. So you can either make a wise decision, go after your life, or stay in your failed business forever and make no change. And just lose a lot of time. And also, what if things go crazy wrong? Like, what if you become very successful? Then what? Are you going to like go all the way until you like as a business go to IPO, like go to the public market and then file for a listing? Are you okay with being acquired by a larger player, or are you okay with a strategic merger? If that's the case, what are the goals that you have? You don't want to be acquired by someone who fundamentally doesn't believe in your core values when you start a social venture, right? So for example, if someone wants to acquire TranQool, and we know that like more people like having access to mental health is not actually what maximizes their profit, then that acquisition might not be a good acquisition for us. But if there is a company who is like times 10 bigger than us and wants like puts a very good deal on the table and says, guys, I have all these great infrastructure, I need you to come and take care of this space, I'll pay like $30 million, $40 million, like $100 million for your company, I will add it to my picture and you will fill a gap, and together we're gonna be times 10 more powerful and you're gonna help more people. Well, that's an acquisition that makes sense, right? So, like, say, okay, like you want to fund. It all goes back to what fundamentally you want to achieve. And then you can actually gauge whether or not you should engage in such transactions.
Right.
And also in terms of unintended consequences, like for example, a company who wants to like provide chickens to like a village in Africa, right? So it's a non-for-profit, there are like non-for-profits in this space, some provide cash, some provide goods, education. Like if you give too many chickens, then like at some point then like that village should be like thinking about what they're gonna do with the disposal. That's a possibility. Right? There are some unintended consequences, second order effects that you should like bring. So what happens if like for example, if we have like in our case, what are the unintended consequences if everyone has access to mental health care on a group benefit plan? Like for example, if every OCADU student, as I said, has $1,000, like I bet none of you know that you guys have $1,000 to spend on your mental health. All you have to do is you have to go to the doctor, get a referral, and they give it right away, because who's gonna disagree with you if you say you're anxious? Every student is, right? So, but no one knows about it. Why? Because that's actually calculated, because that's how insurance works, like based on how many people use a service. One unintended consequence might be if we do a great job in terms of marketing on OCAD, and then all of a sudden, instead of like what they anticipated, like 2% or 3% engagement, like 40% of the students use their plan, then next year you're gonna get a bigger size check from your student union because their insurance is going to charge more because so oh you're using this and then like that it's going to like come back in another way. So these are like some of the examples of unintended consequences. But I think we can all agree, even the insurance company, everybody, the management of the school, the dollar spent in mental health is the best spent dollar. Because as students, like, they're gonna be like more relaxed, they're gonna do better in the school, they're gonna live a better life, and they're gonna down the road when they graduate, first of all, they're gonna be much better students, and then when they go out, they're gonna be much better representatives for their schools and for their campuses. So, but there are some consequences that you might wanna think of. So the economics is like the last part, like figuring out how you're gonna make a business model work. Sometimes like Adam Smith is the father, the godfather of like conventional economics. So he's like, basically his mindset is like people only make decisions based on their interest. And like, so for example, if there's money there, I'll go get it, right? If there's money over there, I'll go get it from there. So like his assumption is everybody, like he calls these people like units of homonocomous, like something like that. Like these are human beings who only make rational decisions. They don't make any irrational decision that's against their interest. So in which basically, in this mindset, you might come to the conclusion that I've never known much good done by those who are affected to trade for the public good. It's an affection, indeed, not very common among merchants, and very few words need to be employed in discussing. Basically the goal is that he says that you can't be a for-profit social venture because it's against, fundamentally against that being a business. Well, Adam Smith has been proven wrong in a lot of aspects, but like that's why the whole field of behavioral economics right now exists, because that brings like behaviors into like people's rational decisions. People usually they make decisions actually based on emotions as well. So if they're not always like trying to maximize their profit, they follow their peers, even though it's irrational. And there's a lot of really good examples. That behavioral economics is my very favorite topic. So in terms of even collecting tax, in terms of like getting people to do like enroll in programs, there's a lot of incentives that like behavioral economics defines to get people to do like things that might not actually be, like, for example, paying tax is not in your good. Like if you're paying out of pocket, you want not to pay. But in behavioral economics, they put together ways to show you that it's actually your best interest. But the bottom line of a social venture is that you want to link doing well to doing good. Like, and I'll explain it with the TranQool example. So we want to make money, of course. And us making money is like with people actually booking sessions, paying us, and transactions happen on the platform. But we have a slogan as like, start feeling better. And it's usually under our logo. And if people actually feel better on our platform, if we make people feel better, there is a business and we are going to make money too. If we don't make people feel better, there is no business. So us doing well is tied to us doing good. And if we fail to do good, from a business perspective, we are not going to do well. And basically, in any type of social venture, for a business social venture, any type of business, imagine like a business as a box. That you're gonna, like, ultimately, you wanna get to a point that you inject some money to it, and the outcome is a little bit more money, right? So that's the goal, you wanna make profit. You're gonna need some money to build the box as well. You need wood, like, you need some bricks and stuff to put together. So that's an initial investment. So if you have a business, if you have a box that you're putting $2 and you're making $1, and you're constantly doing that, basically, you're doing it wrong. And some few terms that you must know if you want to start a social venture. So balance sheet, income statement, cash flow statement, financial planning, and financial vehicles. So these top three are very famous accounting statements that basically you can tell how the business is doing based on them. Balance sheet is a summary of company's liabilities and assets, basically at any given point of time. You can see, okay, is the company that has this much in the bank, has this much of assets in terms of non-cash assets, and this much in this much debt the company should pay out, and then what are the terms of those debts? And income statement shows how you're doing in an operational perspective, in your day-to-day operations, how much money is getting in and how much money is coming out. So you might have $5 million in the bank in terms of your asset, but in a yearly basis, at the end of the year, you're losing let's say $1 million. So your income statement shows that you're not making income and you're actually not you're losing money, but your balance sheet tells you you can keep doing this for 4 more years. Otherwise, you're gonna be out of business. And cash flow statement is going in details into where money comes in and where money goes out in terms of cost of goods sold. And budgeting is basically figuring out how much money you need for doing certain a project. And financial planning, you're going to make a decision based on how much money you want to make out of it or the interest, whether or not you should do that project or not. So for example, as a social venture, you're thinking of expanding to another province. You figure, okay, there is $1 million that I need to go to Quebec. And I want to make 20% or 30% interest or 50%, whatever rate that you have on this investment that I make. So you think, okay, if I go to Quebec, there is X number of people who need therapy. And I think, based on what I see in Ontario, I'm going to engage this number of people. If all of them come on the platform, book X number of sessions, this is how much money I'm going to make over the next 5 years. But the fixed 5 years is very uncertain, so you can't really count on the money that you're going to make in 22. That's why there is a coefficient that you discount it to the time. So at the end, you say, okay, $1 million right now, X million dollars over 5 years, which one is more? And then should I make a decision to make this investment or make this investment somewhere else, which will have a higher return for me. And there's a lot of vehicles to get your finances. You can either get it on, you can issue equity, you can issue different securities, you can issue preferred shares, you can go under debt, and each has its own benefits and of course, damages that's the role of a financial officer to figure out based on where the business is, what the business should do. So also what is very, very useful for you if you have a project in mind is to do a lean canvas on it. So it's basically in one page a summary of everything, your problem, your solution, what's your unique value proposition, and on your customers, who is your customer, and then down below there's how much cost it takes for you to make it, and then how much money are you going to make out of it. And then you have the channels, how I'm going to reach to those customers. So in one page, you have a summary of your business or your idea or your non-for-profit as a whole. So you can look at it and say, well, does this make sense? And can I really get all of that, what I need? And then you can make a decision and move forward. It's actually a very useful thing to do. And basically, that's it. So you in this presentation, we actually reviewed a little bit about what a social venture is, how to build one in terms of the design thinking. And design thinking is not only for your product. It can be for your business as a whole. So you want to design it so it actually delivers value to certain stakeholders and also minimize the amount of opposition that you're going to have throughout the process. And we also reviewed a little bit about finances, and I think the purpose of this program is that you're gonna work on a project on your own, right? Because I know CG was part of this program previously. She did a very, very interesting project with shelters, and there's other people. So, but as long as you follow a couple very simple points that figuring out, okay, like what am I going to do, who is going to benefit from it, who's going to pay for it, and then if you're thinking, even if you're a non-for-profit, somebody has to pay for it, right? Like, period. So otherwise, like, it's just like you need capital somehow, either way. And then like figuring out how you're gonna, the strategy of how you're gonna make it, then you're just, you put yourself in a position that is a chance for you to actually be a, make a great business. So with that, if you have any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them. Thank you. Sure.
Well, that, that's about, you talked about how the win-win situation thing,
sure,
where you're kind of explaining to the practicing people that you're aiming for 2/3 of the market that's they're not touching at all.
Yeah.
But isn't there still like an area that's kind of overlapped, as in it's kind of like Uber and taxis,
yeah,
right? So there is, there's still a bit of overlap area, so do you just kind of like do you always go for a win-win, like communication-wise, or do you just focus on building your side?
Well, I fully exactly. There is like, we have some people coming on platform who has experience with therapy, of course, but you have to think about it from this perspective. So at the end of the day, a therapist who will make more money, even though we get some of the people who has done therapy before coming on our platform at a lower rate. Because if a therapist, if a solo practitioner works in the clinic as an associate, they have to pay overhead, like half of their money. Right?
So do you try to get them on your team, kind of?
We explain to them, and then also what also part of this in a better, right? If people, if their market, right, if their customers want less expensive mental health, they're gonna get it, right? So if, like, for example, if they continue to provide therapy at a rate that people can't afford, only few of them can keep themselves busy, right? Then there's going to be the rest who will actually try to offer it at a lower price, which already are, but usually they're not a really qualified therapist. So those people are existing right now. What we do, and there's only so much you can do in terms of explaining, but you make sure that you do as much as you can to explain. But there are going to be people who wouldn't basically come on board anyway. And they, if that number is like 80% of them are not coming on board, then you're doing it wrong, right? But if there is, you see, like, there's only like a limited number of people, like, they don't like your idea or they think, okay, you suck. Well, like, even Facebook, you think everybody has a Facebook account? I think, no, I mean, Canada, I don't have the right stats, but probably like 70% or 65% of people have a Facebook account. So then there are people who actually hate Facebook, I've seen them. You talk about Facebook, like, no. They're either because of privacy or they don't like Facebook. But at the end of the day, Facebook is a thing, it's a global thing. So you're gonna have fans, you're gonna have people, like, yeah, haters. So which is kind of completely understandable. Yeah.
Are you guys planning any time in the future to like expand to the US?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like this year, we are going to go like to 3 more provinces to close pilots. Other than Ontario, and we're gonna, I think, like right now, our plan is to go nationwide first and then go down to US, but this might very well change, so depending on the business situation. But of course, we wanna go. Yes?
Yeah, just a question. So, before you launch your business, so like, how do you know like market research?
Oh, that's it. Good question. So we let me tell you why we started this business actually. So I was a project financier before this business. I was like actually working in oil and gas, a little bit of carrier shift from oil and gas to mental health. And I was myself like a young professional working really long hours and of course it's stress. And so I had love issues in terms of my work and I needed to see a therapist myself. So when I was thinking about like, and I don't know if you have any experiences, but on a school it's easy, you just go there and then they take care of you. But when you're working, it's very hard. I have to like email these like random people on the web, picking up the phone and telling them about, okay, I feel like anxious, like, or I feel like I'm tired of my work. And it's a very uncomfortable conversation. And they like usually like talk a little bit and then give you a session, like 2 weeks from the time you're asking, or a week from the time you're asking. And this happened to me actually. So I was a manager in my previous company, and I didn't want anyone seeing me talking to a therapist, so I started emailing them on internet. So I emailed like 12, 13 people, explaining like this long email that I'm, okay, I'm a project financier, I work 7 to 7, I'm very stressed, I'm traveling like a gypsy, and I need to see someone because I think my lifestyle is not healthy. And only like one of them responded, said, okay, like, come to my office next Tuesday, 9 a.m. And I'm like, if I could be there next Tuesday, 9 a.m., probably wouldn't have all these issues, right? So I can't skip work. So that was like an issue on my mind. Back to my friend, right now my co-founder, Shekhoman, she literally was at work, reached out to me on Google Hangout. And she was working at GE and had a similar experience, and talked about an idea of doing like this problem, like her experience with this system, and if there is an opportunity for a business, and what I think. And I was like, okay, let's get together, because I'm actually right now living it. And we got together, did some research, and we both use internet in terms of doing research, but also talk to a lot of people. And at first, it was very hard talking to people about mental health, because we were like, what's your experience with mental health? And people were like, whoa, you're not talking about it. But when we learned how to ask questions, how to like frame it so they're not feeling judged, and we explained, okay, like, we have this issue ourselves and we want to like put together a solution, and we realized, oh my God, there is an actual problem. Everybody shares the same concerns. And then, actually through those conversations, we met Catherine, actually, like the Magician Catalyst manager, like in an event, like in a tech event that we were asking like people about like different ideas and like getting their feedback. And then also we did like a lot of surveys. We put surveys to students, we put surveys to young professionals, we put surveys to people like ourselves. We did online service by Google. We paid a little bit just to sort of like trying to validate what we are trying to do is worthwhile. But we didn't know anything about regulations. We didn't know anything about the difference between a psychologist and a social. I didn't even know social workers provide therapy, to be very honest with you. I thought like social workers work at schools. But honestly, yeah, a lot, and that's one of the challenges we have right now, like trying to explain to our users that social workers provide therapy, and even as a matter of fact, the therapists you have on your campus are social workers. And actually, they're like very, very qualified, and they're trained to do this, but there's a perception. Like people, all I knew was the term psychotherapist when I was basically like looking for help. So we try to figure out, like also learn about like what it takes to build a business, what are the limitations, and like for example in terms of personal health information, we seeked out to a lot of people from the community of mental health providers to get them on our site, get them to help us to like make change, and also we got in touch with our privacy like advisors. Trying to like reach out to everyone and tell them, okay, like, and then us being outsiders, I think actually put us in a very unique position because we didn't know, like we had very big ears, so we were not like biased. It was, okay, we have to do this. Like we didn't know, we were just like, there is a problem, let's figure out a solution to it. So we were actually listening to everyone as we were moving forward. Okay, what's like he's saying, what's she saying, let's put it together and like think about it. And then like evolved step by step from a problem to a solution and to a company. That was our journey, how we basically went about like at the very first stage designing and defining the business.
Do you think social enterprises may be at a disadvantage to your conventional business? Like you have the business part, you need to make money, but you also need to have the social benefit, you need to make sure that is working out. Like, do you think you're at a disadvantage because you have to take care of both of those aspects? Because that one extra thing you need to worry about.
Well, interesting enough, no. I think, first of all, I think future is with social enterprises. I think like more and more like millennials, young people are becoming more and more socially aware. Even companies who are exactly against social ventures, they're trying to like come up with an angle of like to present themselves as a B Corps and social ventures and stuff. So I think being a social venture puts you in a better position in terms of like a competitive market. But also, like, it goes back to, again, the bottom line, that if you tie your doing well to doing good, then everything makes sense. For example, us giving free sessions or discounted sessions might not make sense from a business perspective, because we are discounting a service that we are offering, and we have to pay the therapist anyway. So we are stealing from the profit that we are making on the fully paid sessions to pay for disadvantaged people are coming to us and they can't afford our given $80 and $120. But how it's justified is that these people, like, we have had a lot of them, come to us, they can't afford it, but they do want to get better, they do want to feel better, and they use our platform, and at the end of this process, they go out and they become our ambassadors. It's like they're bringing like big time customers to us that they pay full amount, and we haven't spent like that, like whatever dollar that we spent to acquire those customers.
Right.
So it actually went if that one person comes to us at whatever financial status they are, wherever they are, if we help them to feel better overall. If as long as we are like reasonable, of course, we don't want to like do unreasonable stuff. But as long as we remain reasonable, if that person feels better at the end of that process, it's good for us from a moral perspective and from a business perspective.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
They're not like, and that's like why I explain, like, you have to set it up so the social goal and the financial goal actually superimpose each other. If you set up your business in a way that they are like conflicting, then you might have some challenges down there. You might like be in a position to make tough decisions in terms
right.
of like prioritizing.
Right. Another issue that we thought about was so in the past there have been some companies who would pose themselves as a social venture.
Yeah.
But would their product or service would be double the price of what's on the market to make a regular margin.
Yeah.
And that created like kind of a stigmatism towards some social ventures. So do you still feel that stigmatism today, or is that kind of all passed up?
Well, I haven't personally felt any, but there are some like companies like they call themselves like B Corps, you've heard about them. They're great, like they put social values in, but I think like a true social venture, it's more than like just like telling to people that you're a social venture. At the end of the day, like actions talk much louder than words. So if a company is taking the steps to do good, people will realize. And if the company like goes like all for like my social venture, like in PR, in media, at the end of the day, they make decisions that's against the public good, people would again like, notice and people would understand. So I think I haven't felt any skepticism
okay.
in terms of like, and we don't usually call ourselves like a social venture, although
right.
we in legal papers we do, but when we explain we don't specify what type of business we are, and I think it's pretty obvious like we are a social
venture.
Yeah.
I think the stigmatism that you talk about is more towards like fair trade or like organic food, right?
Yeah, like an example I could think of would be a company sells toothbrushes and everyone's selling toothbrushes for $5. They're selling for $10, but their gimmick is every time you buy a toothbrush, we send one to Africa, but it's $10 so that they can make the same margin.
But that's like a different business model.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
Sure. I do have a
question.
Sure. This is a topic that we discussed in a couple classes after my courses, and one thing that I realized when I was doing my research is that dependent on your region, the idea and concept of social enterprise like differs from place to place. This, like, especially between the Americas and like our eastern brethren, where social enterprise here is usually focused on things like qualities like philanthropy. You're giving something, and you're helping somebody in need. Whereas if we go across to another continent, it could very well mean like a mutual benefit scenario. Social enterprise can be a system put in place so that both people mutually benefit. It's not explicitly stated, but I also wonder if your company, and I'm guilty of not having done my research, should you get big enough, is expansion to another region in your plans? Would you want to venture out into different territory?
Well, we were thinking of this would be like what you explained would be like far, far away from us in terms of like timing. So if I tell you like we know after like Canada and US where are we going, I'd be lying. So because there is, I think over the next like 3-4 years, 5 years very well, like there's 52 states. We have 13 provinces, and we have to go one by one because of regulations. So like, there's a lot of need to keep us busy for the next like little while. But going out of these two markets, like one market that actually I myself like thought about is actually like Japan, because they like based on what you read, and also like we did have a Japanese like therapist, and she was like. We were keeping her busy. A lot of like Canadian Japanese people actually were coming to us. So they are from a cultural perspective. They find like the concept of therapy is I think more popular in Japan based on my very like raw research than like a country like Vietnam. So that's as much as I can tell because that's as much as I thought about it. So if I tell you, like, I know exactly where we are going to go after, I'll probably be lying to you.
Okay, that's fine. Because you have to conquer whatever is here before you can go elsewhere.
Exactly.
I do have another question.
Sure.
Obviously, you have to do a lot of market research, as with any development of a product. Do you have, like, a board for it, or is it just a couple of people that discuss what you want to do?
No, actually, we do have a board.
You have
every corporation has a board of directors and has a board of shareholders.
Okay.
So right now, board of directors is the founders, but as we move forward, we bring on more investors. They might very well want to get a board seat. So the decisions for a business, it depends. If the decision is like go to make it depending on the bylaws of a company, that decision could be made by the board of directors or could be basically transferred to an officer or executive or to the board of shareholders. But we do have a board there.
That does answer my question. I'm going to branch off into like another tangent. Our teachers really love the idea of design strategy. And it's, no, I'm serious, guys, hear me out. And based off of what Derek says, there's always corporation and like companies have a big, there's a new emphasis on direction. And I was just wondering if, sorry, I'm getting a little bit lost.
Take your time.
Is there a space for people like us? Because there's a new demand for this. Business needs to wear more hats. And there's like, the experiential aspect to almost everything that's developed nowadays, that it's important to somebody, it's important to have somebody that can think creatively outside of the box.
Of course.
And specifically pertaining to us as students of a creative practice, is there, I'm not asking for a job, I'm just like wondering, is there a place for us in a company such as yours?
Of course. Like the whole idea of people like talking together over video is not like novel. It's been around for a while. But we actually have like a UI UX designer, pure designer on our team full time right now. And to put it in perspective, we only have one full stack developer. So we have a designer and a developer. So basically, they don't have a four dev. So that's how design And fundamentally, the experience is important for us, is a key for us. And as we move forward, actually, we've budgeted to, just telling to the guys back there that we're budgeted for a designer, pure like thinker, creator, to come on board, not only to, because if you look at our website, it's purely like fictional. Like you don't see an image of like a person with a laptop. Like it's not like a blonde like person or like a guy sitting at a table like playing with a computer. It's a tablet sitting on a couch. That's our very like core like asset, right? And when we are moving to our next generation, like even in terms of the questions we're asking, we're defining a journey for the user. So all of this is purely like things that they didn't exist before. So will the market like it? That's something to be known. But do companies like us need like innovators, thinkers, creators? Of course. Because for us, like we're literally developing a market, right? So that before people did not do video therapy. Now they're doing it. Like 5 years from now, maybe they do more, there's more people like doing video therapy than conventional. So like to create something from zero, you have to have people who can imagine that world, that like the circumstances of that world, the needs of that world, and like how things are changing based on like even the consumer behavior. Like right now, like, everybody knows, but we are living it because we are putting advertisement. So 18 to 24, I guess a lot of you guys are in that age group, I'm assuming. When they come to our platform, we put ads on Facebook, Instagram, everywhere. 18 to 24, guess what? A lot of them are coming from Instagram. Like very few come from Facebook. Whereas like 24 to 34, actually a majority of them are coming from Facebook and not Instagram. So this is something like that, like you are more, and then of course Snapchat. So if you just put it in a social media perspective, this population is a different medium that they're used to in terms of socializing online than our generation, right? 29, not that old either. But that's like, in order to design for future sustainable design, we definitely need people who think about all these issues, think about the potential users, what is going on, how the market will be in 5 years. Because if you wait for the market to behave and then react to it, you're 2 years, 2 years behind minimum. So you have to think about how it's going to look like based on what you see, the information you're getting from. Maybe like right now, what we see is a lot of like actually people younger than you in high schools, they like texting a lot. I guess like no one hates texting. Everybody loves texting. But I actually yesterday I was speaking at another event. I met the co-founder of a company, a very successful like Montreal-based company that they are doing business in U.S. and they do like tutoring for high schools. And they put together a video platform and scrapped it because like students didn't want to do video with their tutor. They want to chat with their tutor. So they have like a chatting platform right now. So it's like, yeah, so like we are not in that market, but they're graduating. Like they're coming, right? We are not like helping people under 18, but in 4 years, they're going to be our customers, right? So we have to prepare for them. We have to be ready. We have to understand them. Like if we can't like put together a business, like, okay, go use it. And like we're building it for them. If they're not going to use it, there's no point for us even to be around. Mm-hmm. So... yeah, I can't actually, like, yeah, it's very important to have such people on team.
Cool, that's reassuring.
We like to actually call ourselves as being in that, like, specific category as well.
It also occurred to people who, like, make new jobs, right?
Yeah, it sounds like it's pretty new. Who are your competitors, actually?
And there is not a competitor in Canada. Like, have you guys heard about BetterHelp?
Nope.
Any of you? Okay. So they are, like, for example, a company based in US, but what they do is a little bit different. So they're not like, they're video-based therapy, but they match people from like Canada to someone in England, because they're not going by regulation. They call it coaching, and by calling it coaching, they go around regulations. That's as much as I know. because you're recording me, I might be wrong, but because I haven't used their service myself, but I know that they have, like, they are not like going jurisdiction by jurisdiction, so per se, or they might, I don't know. But that's one of the companies that is in this space. It's like Doctor on Demand, it's also a US-based company, but they have like family doctors, like everyone, and also psychologists, which I think is not a model that could work, because the type of consumers who want to see a family doctor are completely different with the consumers who want to see a therapist. So I like to find ourselves actually, like, I think some, like, a sustainable business, because our IP, our core knowledge, is not even our platform. Is the knowledge we have about our users and what they want and the interaction between the user and a client and a therapist. That's our core IP, and that's what I think, like, it's the most important thing for our business. Okay. Have we answered the question?
A question, actually, does anybody else want to ask?
Go for it.
How do you go about, in your, like, the way you're recruiting therapists to help in your in your vision for the future? How are you finding these people?
Did you have Snapchat?
but at the very beginning, like, honestly, I built our network of therapists myself.
Okay.
So at the beginning I was basically calling them and they wouldn't talk to me. Because, like, they're asking my license number. And I didn't have a license number. But what we managed to find, like, I called so many people till I find people who, like, are, like, like-minded. They have thought about technology. They've been, like, waiting for someone to come into this space and change things. And they happen to be thought leaders in their various space. So I built a personal relationship with them. First of all, I learned them. I let them to comment on our platform. Let them shape our business. And then they became our advocates. So right now, we are getting on a daily basis applications on our website for service providers, because we've become a brand, at least in this very specific market of Ontario. So a lot of them know about us. And actually, we have a backlog of therapists right now. We don't, like, onboard. We onboard, like, basically, takes sometimes up to 8 weeks for them to get onboarded, because we have to develop the other side of the market before we onboard them. But they undergo a four-step screening process as well. So I do, but right now I can't do it myself. I don't have time, but I used to do, like, two interviews with them. Like, I have a phone and a video. Right now the phone is done by my associates, and I do still the interview myself. Because, like, I want to make sure we're as good as them, right? So if people don't like them, they don't like us.
What would be your biggest piece of advice for someone who wants to start a social venture or a venture in general?
I would say, like, the most important thing is, like, you have to find a problem and marry to the problem, not to the solution. Because at the end of the day, I told you, like, if, like, the next generation wants to do texting, we don't, like, give it to them or like provide a reasonable alternative, they're not gonna use us. So like, users, you don't care if, like, Nike, like, has a solution or a favorite brand, like, I don't know, like, I forget, like, this jacket's brand, like, what's the name? I have a Canada Goose. Like, let's say Canada Goose or, like, any of your favorite brands. You don't care, like, how, like, they put together a solution. At the end of the day, like, if you don't like it, you're not gonna buy it, right? So the problem is being cold, right? And it's like we have very cold days how we're going to secure ourselves. So each company has a different solution at a different price range. So, like, if I have a very fancy looking code, but it actually fails to keep you warm, like, regardless of, like it's not solving the problem. So it's very important, I think, to, like, find a problem and actually, like, find a group of people who have that problem and try to solve it for them and listen to them to create a solution. Don't be like dictator. Tell them, okay, this is a solution that you're gonna all adapt. Because they might agree with you when you're in person with them, but when you leave, or when they leave, they're not gonna use it because you can't force them.
Right? Definitely.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Sure.
This might be out of context, but I'm curious about the logo you guys chose.
Sure.
What was the thinking behind it?
Actually, that's interesting. Actually, it's not actually our contest. I love your question. I can't show it here. Anyway,
so
if you
what's
go
the question?
The logo.
The logo.
Oh,
like, if you look it up, like it's a very. Can you show it? Actually, give it to me. Give me your computer to me.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is our logo. All of you see? Yeah, so it's a TranQool with a circle with two colors. And so it's, well, the idea behind TranQool is tranquility with coolness, if that makes sense. So, and the idea behind that circle is, first of all, it's a cube. And also it's designed to have both sides, like the dark side of feelings, like the happy and upset feeling. So we want just to show that your mood is always a balance. Like you can't be 100% happy. It's a spectrum. So we want to show, like, use those two colors, and with the font that we have, like, you know, the cube, a big cube, and also like the slogan that's underneath. Like, as a whole, we want to give this message that, like, you're a mixture of feelings, but there's always, and it's a spectrum. So you have to be always, first of all, like, notice your feelings and your mood and your emotions, and always, like, understand that you're not going to get, like, 100% like good or 100% bad, unless, like, yeah, you misuse drugs for a very short period of time, you might feel very good. but yeah, so that was the thinking behind the logo. And we designed it actually ourselves, like the family.
Yeah,
it's great. No, it's nice. And when I first heard about you guys, I read the name TranQool, and it made me think of the word tranquil.
Yeah.
So I don't know if that was also part of the intention.
Yeah.
That was
tranquility.
Yeah. It was really good.
So it's a space to feel better, basically. It's a space for people to come and feel better. Any other questions?
If not, thank you so much for your time.
I enjoyed very well.
Yeah. Thank you for coming.